In late 1955, airline pilots flying over the United States started spotting ominous sights in the skies. Unidentified objects, fiery or silvery, and gliding unnaturally at 60,000 feet. Certainly, no human-made object could fly at that altitude. The stunned pilots filed their sightings with the United States Air Force Development Command in Dayton, Ohio. And the Air Force diligently collected these UFO reports as part of their Operation Blue Book. But the Air Force leadership knew very well what kind of truth was out there, but they never revealed their secret. Of course, they weren't covering the arrival of intelligent species from outer space, but instead were cooperating with the CIA on Project Aquatone, the development of a top-secret reconnaissance plane supposed to be able to fly undetected over the Soviet Union. I'm your host, David, and this week we're looking not at flying saucers, but instead the development of the legendary Lockheed U-2. This is the Cold War. I wake up every day thinking about what new things I'm going to learn as I go about my business. And I am thrilled to include the sponsor of this video, Magellan TV, as one of my go-to sources. We see a lot of information about clandestine operations, and if you're interested in learning about secret anti-Japanese operations in China during the Second World War, then you need to watch Operation Oblivion. This documentary looks at how MI6 trained 13 Chinese-Canadian civilians how to parachute into Japanese-held territory to try and recruit local resistance fighters. And the good news is Magellan TV has much more than that. There are more than 3,000 documentaries waiting for you, and hundreds of them are on the history of various eras. I really love the science and tech documentaries on Magellan TV, as they are a great way to explore the way technology and innovation impact human life and history. New documentaries are added weekly and available on most devices, including phones and PCs. Magellan TV has a kind and exclusive offer for our viewers. Click the link in the description to get a 1 month free trial and watch hundreds of history documentaries anytime, anywhere. This story starts on May 1st, 1954 in Moscow. The skies above Red Square were streaked by the flight of the Soviet Union's newest bomber, the Myasishchev M4 Bison, a four-engine long-range aircraft entering service with Soviet long-range aviation, which was the rough equivalent to the United States Air Force's Strategic Air Command, responsible for delivering bomb payloads to their targets in Europe and the United States. Keep in mind, only the previous summer, the Soviet Union had successfully tested a hydrogen bomb. As a result, the intelligence community in Washington spent more than a few restless nights wondering if the USSR had overtaken the West in terms of both its nuclear arsenal and its ability to deliver it. What the United States required was intelligence. It needed data. Aerial reconnaissance could and did come in handy, but previous attempts to penetrate Soviet airspace had generally failed. As you can imagine, the Soviets frowned on violations of their airspace, and although the use of oblique photography to take pictures from just outside the territorial borders of the USSR had resulted in a great deal of information, what analysts lacked was information on facilities well inside Soviet territory, away from the border. In the pre-satellite age, the answer was to develop a new model of aircraft, capable of flying extremely long distances at altitudes where they could not be intercepted by jets and could even evade Soviet radar systems. This high-altitude platform was only relevant, however, because of recent breakthroughs in camera technology that allowed high-resolution pictures to be taken at altitudes previously thought inconceivable. The project to develop this new plane was authorized by President Eisenhower and then promptly handed over to CIA Director Alan Dulles. In November of 1954, Dulles delegated the project to his special assistant, Richard Bissell. On the 3rd of December, Bissell met representatives of the armed forces at the Pentagon to kick off Project Aquatone, what has become known as the U-2 project. Normally, such an initiative would have been led by the Air Force, but the leadership and main funding of Aquatone would reside with the CIA for three key reasons. One, it would make it easier to keep the entire operation under wraps. Two, it would make it easier to provide plausible deniability if the Soviets captured one of the new planes. And three, CIA control would make it easier for political authorities to authorize reconnaissance missions. So the Air Force promised to contribute several Pratt & Whitney J-57 engines, which they would hand over to manufacturer Lockheed, already selected as the main supplier for the project, but they were not in control of the development of this aircraft. The CIA's Bissell was clearly not one for twiddling his thumbs. Immediately after the Pentagon meeting, he briefed Lockheed, who put one of their best engineers in charge, Clarence Kelly Johnson. Kelly Johnson already had a track record at Lockheed in developing new designs, with both the P-38 Lightning and the P-80 Shooting Star under his belt. Johnson assembled a team of 81 designers and engineers, and inside Lockheed's secretive Lockheed Advanced Development Projects Department, better known as the Skunk Works Division. Johnson and his team then worked 65 hours a week until, in July of 1955, they were able to develop the first prototype of what was first called the Angel and then the Dragon Lady, or U-2. The engineers had followed the CIA's brief and developed a light reconnaissance plane capable of flying above the reach of Soviet anti-aircraft batteries. To achieve overall lightness, Johnson was inspired by the sleek profile of a glider. The most striking characteristics were the wings. Their long, tapered shape allowed the plane to reach heights of up to 73,000 feet. Moreover, they weighed about one-third of the wings of a standard jet. This allowed for maximum fuel efficiency so that the U-2 could cover a range of 3,000 miles. Johnson further reduced the overall weight of the plane by using simple tension bolts. Normally, jet wings would be connected by a wing spar which passed through the fuselage. Johnson ditched the wing spars, bolting each wing separately. This technique also freed up space in the fuselage, which the engineers exploited to house 700 pounds of state-of-the-art photographic equipment, which was the point of the aircraft after all. Potential pilots for the U-2 were selected through a program called Dragon Lady, a name we will return to in a moment. Naturally, Air Force pilots were selected, but in order to be enrolled in the program, they had to resign their Air Force commissions, since officially the U-2 was a civilian plane. All part of the whole plausible deniability aspect of the program. On the 6th of August 1955, Lockheed test pilot Tony LeVier took charge of the U-2's maiden test flight. LeVier may have been mistaken for an astronaut on that day, wearing a specially designed flight suit that was more akin to what future spacesuits would look like. This was needed to protect him at extreme high altitude, but he had other problems than his appearance to focus on. The long, narrow wings of the U-2 made it hellishly difficult to bring back to Earth, and the veteran pilot needed 5 attempts before he could successfully land his Dragon Lady, a name the aircraft earned because of its unforgiving nature towards ineptitude and incompetence. And since this was the 1950s, the racist undertone to the name didn't matter. Further flight tests revealed several major headaches. As it reached its top altitude, the U-2 engines had a tendency to flame out. Basically, the flames in the combustion chamber went out. Johnson's team quickly came up with the solution: the development of a new low-volatility fuel to feed the J-57 engines. With most of the kinks ironed out, Lockheed testers handed over their Angels to CIA pilots for training in the spring of 1956. It had taken the program only a year and a half to move from inception to acceptance. Many of these training flights took place at a base located near Groom Lake, Nevada, a site which most of you already know just by a different name, Area 51. Sightings of the U-2 in flight surely fanned the imagination of ufologists for generations. But the base personnel had other matters to worry about. Test flights were a dangerous affair. A crash shortly after takeoff claimed the life of pilot Wilburn S. Rose on the 15th of May. Nonetheless, testing moved forward, and by late June, Project Aquatone was fully operational. Its main objectives were to capture aerial intelligence on 1. The Soviet capability to build and deploy long-range bombers, and 2. Moscow's progress in the development of intercontinental ballistic missiles, or ICBMs. Aquatone set up several bases from which to launch U-2 missions. European operations were headquartered at the airfields in Gibbelstadt in West Germany, as well as Adana in Turkey. The CIA had also established an office in Wiesbaden dedicated to photo analysis, because what good are the pictures if there's nowhere to process and examine them? In Asia, U-2 flights would be staged from the Atsugi Naval Air Station in Japan, with photo analysis being done at nearby Yokota Air Base. The first operational use of a U-2 took place on June 20, 1956. Eisenhower had not yet given his approval for overflights of the USSR itself, but Bissell was raring to go. Taking advantage of a previously established and far looser authorization process for air reconnaissance over Central and European Soviet satellite states, a U-2 flew over East Germany and Poland. It only took until the following day, the 21st, for the president to give his authorization to fly over the Soviet Union. But on the 23rd, a United States Air Force delegation was to visit the Moscow Air Show as the guests of honor. Could the CIA launch a U-2 mission around that date? It would have been in extremely poor taste. And more importantly, very embarrassing had they been caught. So the next mission, flown on the 2nd of July, again flew over the skies of Central and Eastern Europe. Finally, on July 4, 1956, the first overflight of the Soviet Union was conducted. Pilot Hervé Stockmann flew his U-2 for 6 hours, covering 3,000 miles, almost all above 60,000 feet. With his A2 camera, he captured detailed shots of the Leningrad shipyards, home of the Soviet Navy's submarine construction program. Along the way, Stockmann also got shots of several airfields to compile an inventory of the new Bison heavy bombers. On the 5th of July, pilot Carmine Vito flew along a similar route, looking for further images of the Bisons, as well as the Kaliningrad and Himiki missile plants. The results of those missions were pivotal. According to USAF estimates, the Soviets had 100 Bisons distributed over 9 main airfields. But according to photographic evidence, there were none. As it turned out, the so-called bomber gap just didn't exist. This, of course, hadn't stopped the USAF from using the threat of the bomber gap to obtain funding to build over 750 B-52s and 2,000 B-47s. These first U-2 flights also brought to light that Soviet radar systems could spot the U-2s, but were unable to track them through their entire flight. MiG-15s and MiG-17s had been scrambled to intercept, but the U-2 soared too high to be harassed by the jets, which had a maximum service ceilings of about 54,000 feet. So, unable to bring down the spy plane, the Soviets did the next best thing. On the 10th of July, the United States Embassy in Moscow received a protest note about the overflights, although the Soviets attributed them to medium bombers. They must have thought the pictures were taken from a Canberra, probably based from RAF Luton. Now, Washington's reply on the 19th was a masterpiece of diplomatic half-truth. It was a complete denial that any US military planes had flown over Soviet territory, because they hadn't. After all, the CIA U-2s technically were civilian aircraft. But the Soviet protest was enough for Eisenhower to have second thoughts about Aquitone. He had authorized it on the understanding that Soviet radar would never detect the U-2s. He was also concerned about the reaction of American public opinion. What if they found out that the CIA had violated international law by invading Soviet airspace? The president put a halt on missions over the USSR. The U-2s, however, kept flying over other theaters. Between August and October of 1956, several of those missions surveyed the Middle East, as the Suez Crisis was unfolding. The photographic evidence of British, French, and Israeli military buildup allowed US intelligence to predict the attack on Egypt 3 days in advance. Even after the conflict had started, Eisenhower himself requested frequent U-2 flights over Syria, as that was where the Soviets would concentrate their forces if they intended to intervene as threatened. While the Suez Crisis played out, Bissell repeatedly pressured CIA Director Dulles, as well as the President, to resume flights over the USSR. Eisenhower held out until early November, following the events of the Hungarian Revolution. He authorized a resumption of flights, but with a significant caveat. The U-2s should fly only above Soviet satellite states and along the Soviet border, and not into Soviet territory itself. After months of missions over peripheral targets, in May of 1957, Eisenhower finally partially backtracked. He recognized the need for monitoring the Soviet nuclear program, and so he authorized the resumption of missions over certain territories, such as Kamchatka, Lake Baikal, and the Semipalatinsk Atomic Testing Area. On June the 8th, a new mission took off, this time from Eielson Air Force Base in Alaska. The U-2s returned to action in a big way in August of 1957 with Operation Soft Touch. 9 flights taking off from Lahore in Pakistan returned with a wealth of valuable visual information. Pilot Buster Edens was the first to photograph the Soviet space launch facilities at Baikonur, otherwise known as Tyuratam. A later flight determined that Baikonur could also be used to deploy ICBMs, although we should point out that despite Soviet boasts, the facility had only one launch pad. Another area of interest first photographed by Soft Touch were the nuclear testing grounds at Semipalatinsk. Analysts were thrilled to spot within the frames evidence of a recent low-yield nuclear test. U-2 missions continued in September and October, revealing more details on the Soviet missile development program. One flight over the Kasputin Yar missile test range even took an image of a lone medium-range missile on its launch pad. And weeks later, CIA pilots took detailed photos of the town of Kluchi in Kamchatka, which confirmed their suspicions that it acted as an impact site for ICBM tests. But the overflight extravaganza of 1957 was followed by only a single mission in 1958 on the 1st of March. The yield was nonetheless interesting. Images of a plant in Malaya Sazanka where detonators were assembled for use with nuclear devices. 4 days later, a vigorous Soviet protest convinced Eisenhower to resume the freeze on Aquatone flights, which lasted until late spring of 1959. The president changed his mind following a series of worrying Soviet announcements, which led Washington to suspect that Moscow was now leading in the production of nuclear missiles, specifically ICBMs. In June, 2 joint CIA and Air Force missions surveyed the Soviet-Iranian border. One of them came back with spectacular results, the first telemetry intercept from a Soviet ICBM test caught in mid-flight. Between July 1959 and February 1960, U-2s took to the skies regularly to monitor the missile test range at Baikonur. On this last occasion in February 1960, the pilot was a British citizen, John MacArthur, whose mission participation had been authorized by Prime Minister Macmillan himself. So, what were the findings of all these flights? Well, by this stage, the US Air Force had estimated that the USSR had produced some 100 ICBMs. But while these missions did prove that Baikonur was expanding, there was little to no sign of that many missiles. In fact, photography showed that the USSR was struggling to keep up with the West. The US was well ahead in terms of the sheer number of nuclear missiles. Moreover, images also indicated that the Soviet weapons were better suited for intermediate range strikes rather than intercontinental attacks, and that most of them were unready to fire at all. On the 10th of April 1960, a U-2 took off from Peshawar in Pakistan for what would be the last successful U-2 overflight of the USSR. The pilot took a few snaps at Semipalatinsk before turning back to base. What the CIA did not know is, by that point, Soviet missile designers had developed a high-altitude surface-to-air missile capable of taking down a U-2 even at altitude. In fact, Premier Nikita Khrushchev noted in his memoirs that the spy plane on April 10th should have been shot down, but, quote, our anti-aircraft batteries were caught napping and didn't open fire soon enough. On the 1st of May, the SAM batteries and their operators had clearly already had their nap when they picked up a U-2 flying over Sverdlovsk, that's present-day Yekaterinburg. The S-75 Dvina, or SA-2 Guideline, fired its missiles at the intruder, and a detonation close to the U-2 was enough to damage the fragile aircraft, forcing the pilot, Francis Gary Powers, to bail out. After parachuting down to Soviet soil, he was arrested and a major diplomatic incident was sparked. But the 1960 U-2 incident is the topic for a future episode. The U-2, an aircraft which remains in service to this day, is a creature born of necessity and whose influence and impact on the course of events and politics of the Cold War are likely underrated by many. The data gathered by U-2 overflights was used to help create and refine U.S. nuclear charting plans in the Emergency War Plan of the 1950s, and then the Single Integrated Operations Plan from the 1960s. The U-2 ended up being a key trigger for the Cuban Missile Crisis, but also helped to bring a de-escalation to the same crisis. For an aircraft that went from drawing board to the top of the troposphere in less than 2 years, the U-2 has soared into the pages of history. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have taken clandestine photos of our bell button from an altitude of 70,000 feet, well above any attempts to be intercepted by any rival bell buttons. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of our patrons, since without your help, none of this would be possible week after week. If you aren't a patron, please consider supporting us at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at thecoldwartv. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, I will leave you with the words of JFK. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air, we all cherish our children's future, and we are all mortal.